Hi, my name is Brian Kennish. I'm a developer advocate on the Google Chrome team, and I'm going to show you how to build Google Chrome extensions. We'll start out with an overview of extension building, and then we'll walk through some code and put together an example step by step. But before we get to the technical stuff, let's talk about what extensions are. Google Chrome extensions are mostly small programs that add bits of functionality to Google Chrome. They install instantly without a browser restart, and like Google Chrome, they update silently when new versions are available. We designed the extension system with web developers in mind. If you can create web pages, you know pretty much all you need to know to create Google Chrome extensions. In fact, extensions are implemented with nothing but standard web technologies, HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and so on. An extension is a compressed directory, assigned zip to be exact, with a bunch of web files in it. The one file every extension has to have is a manifest file. It's also the one file that has to have a particular name, which is manifest.json. As the name implies, the manifest file is JSON formatted data, specifically metadata that describes the extension, lists permissions, and points to the extension's other components. Those components are what give the extension its functionality. An extension includes one or more of the following components. Browser actions and page actions are the two UI surfaces the extension system ships with initially. A browser action appears in the toolbar of every tab. A page action selectively appears in the omnibox and can be toggled on or off for each tab. An extension can only have one UI surface or the other. We'd like to encourage extension developers to be as minimal in their design decisions as the Google Chrome team is. Content scripts are arbitrary CSS and JavaScript that are injected into selected pages. They're similar to user scripts and can be used as a UI alternative to browser and page actions. Background pages are long-running scripts that help you manage state and coordinate tasks across extension components. As an extension gets more complex, it tends to need a background page. In addition to these components that are specific to Google Chrome extensions, you can bundle any other web files with your extension. Images, JavaScript libraries, Flash movies, whatever it is your extension needs. The extension API is small and easy to learn. It currently defines about 40 objects and 40 methods. Chrome is the name of the top-level object automatically exposed to all extensions. The API is split into 6 modules, which are represented by objects contained in the Chrome object. Chrome.extension has properties and methods that let you send messages to communicate between extension components and resolve the URLs of extension files. Chrome.browserAction lets you set the appearance of browser actions and their badges, which are mini text areas overlaid on browser actions. Chrome.pageAction lets you enable and disable page actions. Chrome.windows lets you open, close, look up, and update browser windows. It requires tabs permission in your manifest file. That's not a typo. Windows and tabs are so closely related, they share a common permission. Chrome.tabs lets you perform the same actions on tabs. It also requires tabs permission. And Chrome.bookmarks lets you read from and write to the user's bookmarks tree and requires bookmarks permission. Now, let's try this stuff out by iteratively developing an extension. Our extension will be a Google Chrome Twitter client, which we'll call Critter. First, we'll give the extension a basic Hello World type UI. Of course, we need a manifest file. In it, we specify the extension's name, version number, description, and icon. For the UI part, we're going to pick a browser action because, well, we want our tweets handy at all times. We populate the browser action fields with an icon that'll appear in the toolbar, a tooltip that'll appear when the user mouses over the icon, and a pop-up bubble that'll appear when the user clicks on the icon. For now, the pop-up is a trivial HTML file. After installing our extension, we get, as advertised, an icon, a tooltip, and a pop-up. The pop-up asks, wouldn't it be nice to see some tweets here? And I think it would be nice, so let's add some. We'll do so by fetching Twitter's public timeline with XML HTTP request. Back in our manifest file, we ask for permission to make cross-origin requests to twitter.com so we can access Twitter's API. We ask for tabs permission as well so we can open UI links in new tabs. And in our pop-up file, we beef up the HTML by inserting a title and a template to present the attributes of each tweet, a link to the user's profile, their image and name, and the tweet itself. We also have new JavaScript for retrieving and displaying the timeline. When the load event fires, we run an init function to grab references to the different template elements via XPath. That function hands control over to another function to do the XHR work. GetTweets issues a simple request for a JSON feed, and in turn hands control over to the callback function processTweets. The processing function deserializes the incoming JSON using V8's built-in JSON support and stores the result in an array. Iterating through the array of tweets, the update function assigns each template attribute and appends the marked up tweet to the pop-up. Our extension has a lot more going on now, with a polished UI and the most recent public tweets to show off. Our implementation isn't ideal, though. As a last step, let's improve the extension's performance and functionality by refactoring our code. Namely, we should turn our pop-up into a dumb view, so it only knows how to update its display, and offload the rest of the work to a background page. We'll go ahead and add a background page to our manifest. Then we can strip the XHR code out of our pop-up. In place of that code, we throw in a reference to the background page, which is returned by the getBackgroundPage method. The pop-up doesn't collect tweets anymore, so we use the background reference to iterate through the available tweets instead. We move the XHR code to its new digs in the background page, but not without a couple upgrades. I mentioned we could improve the performance and functionality, and here's where we will. Since the background page isn't tied to any DOM event, the page can fetch tweets on a continuous loop. That way, we can batch tweets up and have them ready before a user even invokes the pop-up. We specify a frequency for fetching, 10 seconds for demo purposes, and manage the process with a set interval method. While we're at it, we can also spiff up the UI. We now have a variable number of batch tweets, which is a perfect candidate for display with a browser action badge. We style the badge with set badge background color, and pass in the number of unread tweets with set badge text. Our extension doesn't look a whole lot different right away, but if we let it think for a bit, we see a badge that dynamically updates the tweet count. The pop-up should work identically, although we potentially have a lot more tweets to scroll through now. While this version of Critter makes for a nice toy, there are some features we'd want to add for it to be truly useful. On the top of that list would be incorporating the user's friend timeline, rather than the public timeline, which would require baking OAuth into the extension. Things can get a little hairy there. Luckily, we've already done the heavy lifting for you and have an example of Critter with OAuth support. We also have a further example that handles custom auto-updating. To download that code, the code you just saw, and more, go to code.google.com/chrome/extensions. Thanks for watching, and have fun building Google Chrome extensions.